So this session is going to be talking about the global challenges to meeting climate change goals when it's not just about the United States. They'll be talking about the financial and technology challenges that we've been discussing in the energy transition of the future. And the panel is moderated by John Golden Dubois, who is the president of Western Resource Advocates. He's been on our steering committee for a number of years and helps guide what this symposium looks like. So if you like it, tell John and others that are on the steering committee. It's also in your printed brochure. So we'll get started. Let me introduce to you John Golden Dubois.
Thank you, Maury. Good afternoon. My name is John Golden Dubois. I'm the president of Western Resource Advocates, which is an organization that works across seven western states to protect land, air, and water. Our particular focus is around climate change, working to reduce carbon emissions and to advance clean energy solutions through work at state government level throughout the western region. We started the day today with a conversation about some of the mega trends in energy and in climate reduction strategies. And in where those are going. We started very, very big picture and got to a number of different conversations over the course of the day that included what's happening in the United States, what's happening in the Western region, what is the military doing. The Admiral told us quite a bit about some of the innovations that the Navy is pursuing. And then finally got to a slide or two in the last presentation that talked about the demand curve and what's happening in China. But what we wanted to do with this conversation was really to reach beyond our shores and to begin to talk about what climate change means, what the challenges are, and what the opportunities are in developing nations and in China in particular. And that's where we want to start our conversation today. Before we jump in with our great panelists and I introduce them, I want to provide just a little bit of a reminder of the context for this challenge and how we got to where we are today. Obviously, 6 years of negotiation led to the Paris Climate Accords just a little less than a year ago. That set of agreements did a number of things that haven't happened before. First, set the goal of at a maximum 2 degrees Celsius increase in temperatures, 1.5 in a more ideal scenario. It also bound 186 individual countries to make their own commitments or goals, as you will, to address climate change within their countries. And it was really the first universal and lasting regime that's been established on climate on a global scale. The one piece that hasn't been mentioned today in the conversation of how the agreement was characterized is that this is also the first time that attempted to really resolve some of the disagreements between developed nations and developing nations and created resources that would be transferred from developing nations to from developed nations to developing nations. The agreement since last year has taken a couple of important steps. Just last week, there was an announcement that 55 member nations have agreed to move forward with their part of the climate agreement, and that's one key step. There's another key step. We need to get those 55 nations or more to also represent 55% of global emissions. So we're about 7.5% short of that goal, which would then ensure that the agreement begins to take effect around the country. It looks like we are on schedule for that to happen at the latest by the end of the year, and we would then have a binding agreement. So that's the positioning there. What this means, though, is that the easy part is done, and now the hard work begins, and that is the work of figuring out how we actually take the actions that will result in reduction in emissions. The US leadership we've just talked about has been palpable in this. The partnership with China has been palpable in this and has been very important in driving these conversations. But I think the deputy secretary last night took a quote from Martin Luther King, which I think is pretty important in this. There's a fierce urgency of now. And what we want to talk about here today is how the rest of the world is going to contribute and address some of these issues and the challenges and opportunities that exist there. We have a fantastic panel, and so I want to introduce the panelists, and then we'll start with some of the questions. Jennifer Turner has been the director of the China Environment Forum at the Woodrow Wilson Center for 16 years, where she creates a series of meetings, exchanges, and publications that are focused on a whole variety of issues, including environment, water, energy, and others. She is the Wilson Center's editor of the journal. She runs the China Environment series, and those are a few things about Jennifer. Alex Thier is a leading thinker on policy and development issues, international development, poverty reduction. He has a great video on TEDx, which I'd encourage you all to take a look at, which talks about the eradication of poverty around the world. He has just launched a new venture, which is Triple Helix, and he's working across the globe, I believe, in Rwanda, in Kenya, and also in Myanmar on a series of challenges and opportunities in the energy and other space. He's held leadership positions at USAID, the United Nations, and Stanford University. Mark Safdie, all the way on the left there, is the Worth Chair in Sustainable Development at the University of Colorado at Denver. He took that seat in 2013, but he has more than 30 years of experience with Holland and Hart, and he's been focused on five continents on every type of infrastructure and finance development project. He has extensive experience on financing infrastructure in the energy, healthcare, and water arenas. So let's first address where the last panel left off in some ways, and that is a conversation about China and not only the demand curve, but what's happening there. What are the specific challenges that we need to address and be thinking about in China?
Okay, making sure the AV team knows that I'm up first here. So when we were when we talked together on the phone, I think it was you made the joke and said that, oh yeah, Jennifer's the, or was it you that made that, it's the panda in the room. And then Alex sent me two pictures of pandas, and one was actually a terrifying, scary panda, and I opted for the nice panda. In great part because, you know, there is some good news coming out of China, the country that has some of the most polluted cities in the world, huge CO2 emissions. But in the past 2 years, we've seen coal use for the first time in 30 starting to drop. I mean, last year it dropped by about almost 3%. The year before, you know, a little over 2%. And that's, you know, that's a big shift because this is a country where, is it, let me switch? Sorry. Click. Oh yeah. This is a country where coal is still king. About 66% of the electricity that's produced and consumed in China comes from the coal sector. I mean, since 2000, coal use has been doubling every 6 years. And so that's why, you know, a lot of people were surprised. Click. Click. Are you clicking? I guess he's clicking. A lot of people were probably surprised when the U.S. and China had their own climate agreement. I wasn't. A lot of people in my network weren't, because there's been a lot of not only the U.S. State Department Climate Change Working Group, but dozens of NGOs, think tanks, working with Chinese partners, countless projects. But it's significant. You know, China said, we are going to peak coal by 2030. And then my first thought was, how high is that peak? Because between 2015 and 2030, the electricity production is going to double. Right? I mean, our last panel, they had those nice little bar charts. I didn't give you any pie charts here, but just imagine doubling. So while coal will peak, it's a pretty Himalayan peak. Next slide. Now, China is acting on the climate change issue because, you know, about 5 years ago, the central government, you know, they looked at their researchers, talking with U.S. experts, saying that climate change is having a serious impact on us in terms of, you know, glaciers melting, sea level rise. But really, their climate action really is linked more strongly with pollution problems. I mean, air quality in Chinese cities is horrendous. I mean, there was in 2012 and 2013, Beijing had air quality index for PM2.5 that was up in the 800,000 range. You know, we panic in the U.S. if it gets to 100. And the estimates are that about 1.2 million people die early every year from air pollution. Next slide. So as part of their, you know, their pollution, their war on pollution, you know, the Chinese government has been, they've been, you know, getting rid of some of the old inefficient coal-fired power plants. And right now, China has the largest fleet of ultra-supercritical coal-fired power plants. They're like the Superman of power plants. They're very, you know, energy efficient because they don't use water to cool. They use air. They've also been, now this year, they because of the air pollution concern and they want to cut down coal, is that they're closing 1,000 coal mines. They have about 11,000 mines right now. It means about 1.3 miners are going to be left out and about. You know, it's a huge, it's a concern that some people think that, you know, they have this big coal commitment, they're getting rid of these plants, they're building clean energy, but what it's going to do for labor issues. And that's why we sometimes see in China local governments are still wanting to protect their coal-fired plants, protect their mines. Next slide. China's also the number one producer of wind and solar power. You heard that in the last panel. And also hydropower. Everything in China is extremes. Everything's the most or the biggest or the fastest. Huge electricity transmission lines. You know, we have smart grid here. They have strong grid. Right? They're moving the equivalent of something like 60 Hoover dams, the electricity from coal and hydro from the east to the west. Eastern China, the coastlines consume about 40% of their electricity. Outside world, we consume about 25% of the electricity in the products we consume, right? A lot of electricity needs to produce. They're investing a lot in solar, wind, hydro, but, next slide, coal is still king. and that it is going to take a while, like I said, for them to balance out. But the reason that, you know, they have a lot of coal, and in terms of some of the banning of expanding coal-fired power plants, they say the ones that are in planning can go forward. We have 300 coal-fired power plants that are being constructed right now, even though they're having they have excess power in the system right now. But it's still being produced. And one example recently, I heard that in Gansu province, huge wind farm, and they wanted to sell it to Hunan province, and Hunan said, nah, buyao, don't want it, because we want to build a coal-fired power plant. Why don't you try Jiangsu? Jiangsu's like, buyao, we don't want that. And so, and it's also hard, too, getting all this wind onto the grid. And in the last panel, when they talked about the question of battery storage, China's investing a lot in that. They're the number one investor in clean energy technologies. Last couple slides here. While air pollution is a huge problem of coal, big cost, another cost that a lot of my research that we've done over 6 years called Choke Point China has been looking at the coal-water confrontations. How much water is coal using? We estimate of all the water used in China, 20% is going to the coal sector. That's not counting what's being polluted. And the estimates that the amount of water China has in the north, it's very, very little. China doesn't have enough to make that work. They're transferring the equivalent of like Lake Erie from southern China to the north to feed industry and cities in the north. But it's a huge cost, and it's just not worth it. And so to kind of wrap up my thinking of challenge of the coal in China is thinking about urbanization. That China's going to urbanize another 300 million people over the next 5 to 10 years. And there's the glorious city of Beijing. Beijing, it's 21 million people. I think we throw about four Colorados in that city for equal the population. To think about how it's expanding, 2007, this was their subway. Next slide. 2015, they have about 17 lines. It's the world's longest subway. And as I live, for any of you from DC, just so you know, to feel really bad, trains come every 3 minutes. And it's so efficient, it's terrifying. But of course, it's going to get even bigger. We're going to have like 30 lines in 2020. And to make this happen, you need cement, you need steel, you need coal. Next slide. Above ground, we've got roads. My last slide here. There are 6 ring roads going around Beijing. The 6th ring road is about 81 miles. This big one there, that's the proposed 7th ring road. God knows how long that is. It's huge. But that's going to need cement. But on that is cars, right? A lot of talk today has been more about coal, but the car pollution, that's in the next 5 years, will surpass coal's contribution to greenhouse gas emissions. And I sometimes think that eventually we're going to have an 8th ring road that will go around Moscow. But yeah, so I'm going to leave it at that. I think I gave them enough information to be dangerous and going to pass the mic.
Jennifer, we're going to come back to that. Alex, you have said that there are no silver bullets in development. And as developing nations seek to manage their emissions, there are also obviously other imperatives. How do they develop in ways that go beyond just what's happening in the energy sector and the transportation sector? How do they create standards of living? How do they move people out of poverty? Talk to us about some of the challenges that you see in the developing world.
So thanks, John, and thanks to Mari, who's done such an amazing job with this. So I'm going to continue with the uplifting remarks that Jennifer made as we talk about challenges, but then we're going to come to something happy. Based on the news this week, who here is excited to have humanity's sustainable future not be on Mars? I'm among those. No offense, Elon, but pulling off of that, I want to talk about three things, or three sets of things that we know right now. The first set are what I call our planet, its inhabitants, and their love of stuff. So we know with a certainty that greenhouse gas emissions today, at current levels, let alone growing levels, will lead, in fact, are leading to catastrophic consequences for many people that are going to be very, very, very expensive. That is the path of Typhoon Haiyan, which hit the Philippines, among other places, a few years ago. Still, as far as I know, the strongest recorded storm in history, at least since we've been tracking. This is a slightly more human view of Tacloban and what happened. That ship was not inshore for cleaning before the typhoon struck. And hopefully that boy was not toting an AK-47. But that kind of vision of what happens, particularly in places that aren't resilient, these are the places that are going to bear the brunt of climate change, and it's going to get increasingly ugly. What else do we know? Well, we know that the world's population by 2050, and this is really almost a certainty just based on the number of people in the world today, is going to grow to over 9 billion people in 2050 and over 11 billion by 2100. Now, the thing that's amazing about this chart, of course, it's even better to look at it here, is that everywhere in the world basically is going to flatline except for Africa. All of those billions of people, virtually 3 of the 4 billion people that are going to be added to the planet are going to be in Africa. Now, we also know from this heat map here that Americans today use more than 10 times the amount of energy on average than what somebody does in sub-Saharan Africa. So you put these two things together and you think about all these people who are going to be showing up in sub-Saharan Africa and all of the energy that they're not using today. Another way of looking at this is my favorite global depiction of inequality, the Earth at night. It's very dark. I don't even know if from your seats you can see Africa. So what else do we know is that thanks to the greatest era of extreme poverty reduction that our planet has ever seen, that many of those people that we're talking about today in that picture and who are going to be added are going to have more income, and they're going to want more food, and they're going to want more connectivity, and they're going to want more appliances. And the truth of the world depicted on this slide is that the interlinkage between the measure of social progress around the world and the consumption of energy is unmistakable. Okay, so the second set of things I want to mention briefly are what I call the energy path. So we know, and many people have been talking about this during the symposium, that more and more of the energy we produce is going to be renewable. I mean, you look at this, we've seen it in slide after slide. It's amazing what's happening all around the world. But we also know, and I think Jennifer really just spoke to this, that much more of that energy that's going to get produced in the next couple of decades could be renewable, but might not be. We also know that energy efficiency can be massively improved from where it is today. And we know, again, that people who are struggling to get their first mobile phone or TV or sewing machine or washing machine are not going to wait for the geostationary spaced wind ionizers or whatever somebody here is going to invent in the next couple of years, if coal power can get them just a tiny fraction of what we all here have and take for granted today. So the last basket of things are what I call the hurdles and nudges. Those things that we are going to have to overcome, or those steps that we are going to have to take to move us towards a more clean, renewable, sustainable energy future. First of all, we know, and it's true in the United States, try going abroad, maybe with the exception of China, that it is incredibly expensive and incredibly slow to build new infrastructure. We also know that governments like to control and regulate the production and the distribution and the pricing of energy. So there are huge policy consequences to the types of shifts that we're talking about, particularly in governments around the developing world that often don't have the policy capacity, the scientific wherewithal to be able to make the right decisions for themselves, not because they don't want it, but because that capacity is often limited. I tell a story about Ethiopia later if we get to it that's really puts a point on this. And we also know that many developing countries are going to continue to lack overall the capacity. They will face corruption and they will face conflict that will stand in the way of the type of progress that we really need to see to avoid the worst possible consequences. So the last thing is, what do we do with all of this knowledge, all of these things that we know? A couple of really quick things. This is an environment problem. And what I mean by that is not the climate type of environment. This is ultimately an enabling environment problem. It is the type of problem that is solved by a couple of different factors, and this is where I'll stop. First of all, most importantly, political will. You know, it's wonderful to see someone like Governor Ritter, who did these things, worked for this state, is now writing about it and thinking about the future. You need that type of leadership around the world, because I will tell you, in country after country where I have worked, leadership matters. These things are not just trends. They don't happen on their own. It ultimately comes down to individuals sitting in a room making decisions, and they often have to be nudged in the right direction. The second, which is often as important as that political will, is finance. And this is where a lot of the really big nudges come in. We know with a certainty that coal power plants, all of these 300 coal power plants, are going to be more expensive for humanity than if every single one of those kilowatts was from renewable energy. We know that. But we don't calculate those costs in a way that allows us to finance the alternative today. And that is going to have to change. And people are trying to change it. We created a clean energy fund a couple of years ago. There are a lot of exciting ideas from the World Bank to organizations like USAID that I used to work for that are looking at creative means of financing today to diminish those risks of climate change tomorrow. But we are far, far, far away, if you look at the numbers, from having the sorts of resources that it's going to take to make these changes. And the last thing that I will say is about thinking about risk. You know, the people who do the financing, the people who are making policy decisions, are making those decisions based on what's happening for them today. And what we need to do is to figure out how to shift the risk calculations, and whether it's from donors or from banks or from governments, to really begin to incorporate those risks of what happens to the world if we don't make those changes going forward. And I'd love to talk about some specific examples I've seen where this has worked and where it hasn't, but maybe we'll leave that to next.
Mark, you have spent the better part of your career addressing some of those risks and figuring out how to spur investment and projects of just these sort, some around clean energy, others around other types of infrastructure, water infrastructure, wastewater treatment, a whole series of things. Given the correlation that Alex showed us between poverty and energy use, how can we begin to address these things, and what are some of the challenges that we see in that environment?
Thanks, John, and hello. I thought I knew what I wanted to say today, and I've now listened to my fellow panelists, and I don't know what to say. I think I want them to solve the problem. But I'll take a little crack at it. Population growth. Alex made a couple of references to 10 billion people on the planet by 2050. There are a lot of credible studies out there from the United Nations and others that say we've already surpassed the carrying capacity of the planet in terms of the population, that if everyone on the planet aspired to or did actually live at the standard that we do in the Western world, we would not be able to sustain our existence. We have too many people. We don't have enough resources to provide them that standard of living. 1.3, 1.5 billion people, depending on the source you look at, in the world today have no access to electricity. Okay? I don't mean it goes off during parts of the day. I mean they don't have any. Zero access to electricity. 1.3 to 1.5 billion people on the planet. These people are about equally divided between developing Southeast Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. About 10 countries, names of which you all know, India, Bangladesh, Nigeria, Uganda, Kenya, have access levels that are so far below what we would expect and hope for in the developed world that those 10 countries together represent a vast majority of the total 1.3 to 1.5 billion people. So this is an issue that's been important to me for a long time. I've done a lot of work in Africa and Sub-Saharan Africa. I have stories I could tell you for hours about tragic but tragicomic failures of development of projects and the reasons they fail. It's just astounding and hilarious. So I've dedicated a lot of my professional career to thinking about those obstacles and those challenges and barriers, you know, up to and including spending a significant amount of time with a research assistant in Sub-Saharan Africa and East Africa specifically over the last few years looking at what those challenges and barriers are. But it comes back to Alex's point. We have to electrify this population. There are carbon dioxide and climate change implications of electrifying 1.3 billion people. There are also massive capital requirements associated with the electrification of that many people. Those are the two things I want to make a couple of points about very briefly in my remarks here. Why electrify all these people? The answer is poverty. If you want to reduce, alleviate poverty, if you want to spur economic development, if you want people in the developing world to have jobs, to be productive, to have the means of caring for themselves and their families, electrification is core. It's central. Why do we want to lift people out of poverty? Because we know there is one thing, and maybe only one thing, that works in terms of population growth. It's the elimination of poverty. When people are no longer poor, when they're no longer struggling for subsistence existences, they tend demonstrably to have smaller families, to live closer together, to be more productive. So I think electrification is kind of at the core of all that. So I want to take on a couple of factoids, maybe a little bit of myth-busting. I hear people say the electrification of 1.5 billion people on the planet is going to be devastating from a climate change perspective. Well, let's take a step back. The Millennium Development Goals, which morphed into the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations and other global organizations, talk about, as a major goal, the electrification of this 1.3 or 1.5 billion people. They talk about and define, the International Energy Association has defined, along with the UN, what they perceive the adequate level of electrification to be to say that they have achieved basic electrification. Those goals are, and by the way, I don't have any PowerPoints because they're for the intellectually weak. They're for the intellectually weak speakers, but they're also for the intellectually weak audience because you have to pay attention because I'm going to get about three numbers in here, and they're only ones you have to remember. The electrification in the developing world that these international organizations strive for has been defined, and there is a defined level of electrification that's deemed acceptable, and it is for rural dwellers in the developing world, 250 kilowatt hours a year of electricity, and for urban dwellers, 500 kilowatt hours of electricity. This is a smart crowd. Everybody knows how much that is. Pick a city of 100,000 people in Sub-Saharan Africa, in Uganda, Rwanda. Pick any city of 50 to 100,000 people. More energy is consumed in this building in the next hour than will be consumed in that city of 100,000 all day in this building. Okay. 250 kilowatt hours a year for a rural dweller allows that dweller to turn on 2.5 light bulbs for 12% of the year, okay, for about 6 or 7 weeks. 500 kilowatt hours for the urban dweller allows you to go down to Lowe's or Home Depot and buy the most efficient, smallest Energy Star refrigerator and run it all year long. But that's it. That's all you get. Okay. These electrification goals are modest, but they're important. They're a stepping stone. One number I want you to carry away. You can look at any number of sources for this information. They're all within a very close range in terms of estimates. To achieve that level of electrification would have a CO2 impact, a climate change impact. What would it be? It would be about 1% increase in CO2 emissions to achieve those goals for 1.3 billion people, assuming the MDG levels of penetration, if all of that development is accomplished with fossil fuels. If it's accomplished with any combination of other non-CO2 or non-greenhouse gas emitting projects, obviously it's going to be significantly less, 1%. How much is it going to cost? How much will it cost to build the infrastructure? All kinds of assumptions you can make here about what kind of infrastructure. How much will it cost to pull in the infrastructure necessary to develop the projects to supply 1.3 to 1.5 billion people with this level of electrification? Ban Ki-moon said it was going to cost about $50 billion a year out to 2030. Okay. Other competent studies, including one by the International Energy Association, says more like $30 billion out to 2030. Well, you can kind of cut that up any way you want, but a number you can rest on pretty quickly if you just average that out is about $500 billion to 2030. In order to maintain, just maintain, the electric system in the developed world at its current level and to expand it to address new demand out to 2030, will require an estimated $9.6 trillion in capital. The capital needed to electrify the underserved and unserved people in the world is about 5% of what we'll spend to maintain and expand the system out to 2030 that the developed world has now. There is plenty of money. 30 years I've been financing infrastructure. There's money falling all over itself. There's money chasing projects, chasing deals. It's the unique barriers and challenges to development in that part of the world, and the unique challenges and barriers to financing in the developing part of the world that are the biggest issue that need to be addressed. I'll say just a couple words generally, John, about those challenges, and then we can get into them a little more deeply as we progress. But those challenges, I tend to categorize, I break them up into kind of four categories. It makes it easier for me to think about them and to address them. And I really think the four categories are pretty simple. There are cultural, social, and environmental problems. There are cultural issues associated with the desire to electrify on the one hand, and the desire of the people who we want to electrify to not be electrified, or to not be electrified in a way that's disruptive to their culture and to their society and to their way of living. There are technical challenges that abound, but great universities like CSU and other organizations around the world are addressing those challenges. There are political and institutional challenges everywhere. There are within the political and institutional challenge arena, there's corruption. There's extensive corruption. I had the great privilege and deeply frustrating experience to try to develop a natural gas-fired power plant in Nigeria and on Bonny Island in the Delta, and it was more years than I want to say before we all just walked away. The company that was trying to develop was just unable to complete it. And then finally, there are the economic challenges. But we can, I guess, get into some of those challenges and maybe some solutions a little more as we talk. But there you have it. The Paris commitment, John, is $100 billion by 2020 to aid the development of clean energy in the developing world, in the poorest parts of the world. It's a good start. It's a down payment of 20% or 25% on some money we have to spend out to 2050, mainly to solve the population growth problem.
So you all have identified a whole variety of challenges, from more 1.3 million coal miners unemployed in China, to more cars on the road in China, to the challenges of the most vulnerable in the face of climate change and catastrophic weather, to corruption, a whole series of things. Let's turn our attention for just a moment to some of the opportunities that each of you sees in addressing climate and what that means for developing nations, for China. Alex, why don't you start this way?
So I'm glad you asked that, because I am actually by nature incredibly optimistic about what's happening in the developing world. I made this point, and Mark referenced the Millennium Development Goals. I always have to say it whenever I talk, because it's so incredible. Do you know that in the last 25 years, we have gone from 42% of the people on this earth living in extreme poverty, under a dollar a day or $1.25 a day, the number keeps moving a little bit at the World Bank, to under 10% today? 42% to under 10% in 25 years. So many people coming out of extreme poverty. Now, these people are still poor. It's not like they got rich, but the difference between the opportunity to live a life of basic human dignity, to get enough food, to be able to send your kids to school, to be able to get medicine, it's an incredible transformation that the planet is undergoing. And then when you add to that things like the connectivity revolution, which has happened all over the developing world. I mean, I was in Democratic Republic of Congo about 2 years ago, and I got off the plane in Eastern Congo. If you know anything about Congo, you know Eastern Congo is like the end of the end. And you know, all of my emails start downloading on my phone, which was not great. But anyway, it was good. It's good for them. It's good for them. No, it wasn't good for me. The changes that are happening are remarkable. And then that last slide that I had up that I didn't talk about too much, the most amazing thing, and this is something that I've been working on in the last 9 months, is that for the first time in history, it is now conceivable that all of these people that we are talking about, people living in remote villages, people who don't have access to the grid, people who are too poor for the grid to have been worth extending to them, suddenly, for the first time, it is going to be cheaper to build grids that will serve that population at an affordable price that does not require the extension of the grid and can be done with renewable energy. And that's only possible in the last couple of years, in part because of the technology, and the price of the technology is just plummeting, solar panels and other things that we've heard about, but in part because, as Mark was describing, you know, we didn't have an energy goal in the Millennium Development Goals. We have one now in the Sustainable Development Goals. This idea has caught the world's imagination. You go out to places like here, people who are working on it, Silicon Valley, all over the place. There's all these young people who are just dying to be part of the solution that is going to create energy for all of the people that we're talking about, and that's not going to destroy the planet. And there's money from impact investment and other things like that that are moving in that just never existed before. And so there's a wealth of people working on this. There's a wealth of money and opportunity. There are exciting things happening with the technology, but you have to bring this all down then to reality, because it actually ultimately means building things, building projects. And when you get to that level, it starts to get tricky and complicated. So I'll just tell this story quickly about Ethiopia. We were working on building a geothermal power plant in Ethiopia. The Rift Valley has incredible geothermal potential. The Ethiopians are not known for their love of the private sector, but this was going to be the first time that the government of Ethiopia had ever made an agreement with a private power producer to build the plant and to purchase that energy from them. And so we were going through this process and every conceivable thing that you could think of to make this project work. We had Reykjavik Energy, which is an Icelandic-American firm. We had a lot of donor financing that was going to help to create some of the subsidy necessary. There was private financing lined up. And this this thing is sitting on the Minister of Energy's desk for months and months and months. And why? And finally, I went to Ethiopia and we were talking about what's going on. Ethiopia does not have a single transaction lawyer with the level of sophistication to be able to read that contract and make sure they're not getting screwed. And that is what they are concerned about. They are concerned about getting screwed in these deals. And so you have to figure out, what do we do? You know, we only identified that through conversations. It wasn't in any manual or handbook. And ultimately, what we had to do was find an Ethiopian-American lawyer who could basically be hired but given to the government, so he was their guy, not our guy, and let him work through the issues that the Ethiopians needed to understand for the project to move forward. The second thing that came up, currency convertibility. People are going to pay for their power in local currency. This is an international company. The currency is not easily convertible, or it fluctuates in value. What do you do about that? Step after step like that have to be confronted and worked through intensively and assiduously to make these things actually come to fruition. So you got to have the high-mindedness and the sustainable development goals and the forums like this, but at the same time, you need people on the ground working these problems to death if they're actually going to move forward.
Great. Mark, one of the opportunities that exists is the $100 billion a year annual fund that goes from developed nations to developing nations. What's $100 billion do? Is there reason to be optimistic in that $100 billion?
It's a lot of money. And with $100 billion, you can build a lot of infrastructure. But I think Alex has really hit the point, hit the bullseye with this. It is about the money, certainly. It's always about the money. But it's also about profoundly the lack of capacity in these countries, the lack of trained personnel with the capacity to deal with large-scale infrastructure, finance, and development, and the kind of complex contractual infrastructure that goes along with these developments. You need long-term supply contracts for all of the inputs to the facility. You need long-term contracts for the sale of the electric energy from this facility. There are, in the developing world, so few people that have had the opportunity, the blessing, to go learn and have the capacity. And most of the rest of the time, what we're doing, particularly in East Africa, is mostly European money, is being spent to send people from power companies in Uganda and Rwanda and Kenya and Tanzania to seminars in Brussels and Amsterdam and London to learn about things. And they're all saying on the ground in places in East Africa, bullshit, we don't need that. Can you send, you know, the last time I was in Rwanda, the president of the power company there said, are you familiar with the American movie, The Intern? And I said, yeah, I've seen previews of it. It's the one where is it De Niro or somebody plays an elderly gentleman who goes in and works as an intern for a woman in a startup company and ends up being very helpful to her. He said, we need people like the intern. We need people to come here and sit with us while we know. We don't need to be sent to seminars. So it's about the $100 million for infrastructure. It has to be more about addressing these human barriers and all of the non-financial barriers that exist to development in that part of the world. And there are many, and corruption is lead among them. I went to Nigeria a few years ago, Alex. I want to tell one quick story. To work with a major multinational vertically integrated oil and gas company who has a concession to drill for oil and gas in Nigeria. The government of Nigeria approached this company and the other two major companies that have operations in Nigeria and said, our power system is broken. They operate a system in Nigeria that is about a third the size of Colorado's for 190 million people. Okay, and the ministers and the president of the country at the time went to these three companies and said, if you value your concession to drill for oil and gas in our country, you will build us a new gas-fired power plant, and each of you has the responsibility to build one. And the first question that some wise-ass lawyer in the room asks is, isn't that a violation of the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act? We are building and giving them a power plant in order to keep and secure our concession to drill for oil and gas. Well, maybe. But the short of it is that the money was there, but the system was so corrupt, and there are 16 ministers within the country attended every single meeting about the development of a 300 megawatt plant because they all wanted to know where their revenue stream would come from this plant. Great. Good start. If it's spent and allocated properly, John.
Jennifer, reasons for hope from your experience in China.
Oh, I have so many. There's not enough time. But
you
but
can
so,
share well, a few.
Well, few. One thing that I mean, finance problems. Not a problem in China, right? Number one investor in clean energy. And in terms of infrastructure, you all know that every Chinese engineer, they all have the same tattoo, right? It says nothing's too big, nothing's too fast. This is a country that has got high-speed trains, dams, and they're building the coal-fired power plants. But things go quite quickly. But the challenge is often, you know, more like the software, right? The people. And what good news is that since the mid-1980s, we've had Natural Resource Defense Council, a lot of U.S. NGOs and think tanks and researchers going and building partnerships. The Energy Foundation has an office in Beijing. And I have a lot of, in my job, I'm an information clearinghouse. I put on meetings, do exchanges. And I can testify, the fingerprints of a lot of U.S. organizations are on the laws in China. Because, you know, they came to us. The Chinese come all the time with delegations. How does this work? Why do you do this? And so that they know that they need this kind of help. They have a CO2 emissions trading pilots going on in China. Well, they don't really have good benchmarking data. That could be a problem, right? And so you get Energy Foundation giving grants to the EPA and others to help work with the Chinese on this. And so that's why, I mean, people ask me a lot of times, how can you be so optimistic? And it's because I've seen, you know, within China, the movers and shakers and the government, the NGO and the research sphere who are really open to working with the US and taking lessons. I mean, they don't want our money. Right? I mean, even that said, the environmental NGO community almost depends almost 100% on you international foundations. And they've really also been kind of from the bottom up, creating pressure and pushing for transparency. And so that those are things that China really needs to keep moving forward on, you know, for your clean energy economy. You can't make the transition if it's all, you know, closed information.
Great. We're going to turn to questions from the audience now.
Good afternoon. Robert Youngberg, Senior Advisor with the Jackson Hole Center for Global Affairs. We've been working with China for about 10, 12 years. And Jennifer, I really enjoyed your presentation on China. Just returned from about 10 days where we presented at the Global Low Carbon Development Symposium. And that was in Taoyuan, capital of Shaanxi, the largest coal producing province. But one other example of China. That city is the first major city in the world to have all electric taxi cabs. They've ordered over somewhere around 7,000 or 8,000 taxi cabs too. And I've ridden in them. They're just beautiful, beautiful vehicles. So just another example of their major efforts there. But my question to the panel is that, and I haven't heard it discussed too much, is the status of the small island nations that are suing the developing country through the Hague or whatever. I wonder if the panel has some comments on the status of that and the ramifications. Thank you.
I am not sure why everyone's looking at me. Maybe it's that JV thing.
You're the one that's intellectually above us.
I see. Yeah.
You're the lawyer.
Can we get that clip for me, that little, just that 3-second video clip where she says, I'd like to post that on my... I don't have a Facebook page, but demonstrating that I am not the intellectual superior. I think these actions, and personal little bit of editorializing here, but I think that the use of tools like lawsuits, whether in the court system in the US of the kind that the Alaskan native population brought a couple of years or 3 years ago against all the major energy companies in the U.S. for destroying their habitat, which ultimately, as you all know, was rejected at the Ninth Circuit. I think there's planning going on for more of those kinds of suits. The international legal actions being brought at tribunals like in The Hague have a purpose, in my opinion. They raise consciousness. They provide a forum for the debate of some of these issues. But I don't think that's how you make progress. I think you maybe poke somebody in the eye with something like that, and when it stops hurting, they figure out how to not be poked in the eye again. But I think the kind of progress that we need to see is coming from the kinds of efforts that people who are speaking at and attending this conference and carrying this agenda forward are providing. I'm frankly not a great supporter or advocate of those kinds of legal actions, and I don't think they're gonna produce a lot of progressive movement. Just just a personal opinion.
We've got a question in the back, then we'll come up front.
Hello, my name is Colin Gould. I'm a graduate student here. So I'm going to sort of flip the idea that we have it so great here on its head. You know, if we are really to reduce our CO2 emissions by a lot, we've got some serious issues to resolve, like baseload problems, you know, the whole duck curve thing. And so if you take maybe Africa as a case study, as not a blank check, but a clean slate sort of, to reach an industrialized level of electricity, what's like an ideal scenario, an ideal way to get there that you can envision? Like, well, you know, smaller grids, different sources. You know, we sort of came online in an era where all this technology wasn't available, and so we built up infrastructure that was maybe based on 20th century technology. So what's any of you or all of you, what kind of ideal infrastructure would you like to see to make that happen and make it easier to keep CO2 levels low?
Yeah. So we've got some great lessons from what happened with mobile telephony and connectivity, right? It's like the problem of the airlines here in the United States. And when you don't have the legacy of these systems that are going to cost us $9.6 billion or whatever the amount was to just maintain, there's a lot you can do, right? One of the most interesting things that the mobile revolution brought in Africa was, of course, the skipping of landlines. We didn't lay all of those landlines. You didn't have to crisscross the country with very expensive technology and then keep it up and maintain it. And so how do you apply that back again to this idea of a village level microgrids and things like that? You know, you don't have to necessarily extend the grid everywhere. It might make a lot more sense for all kinds of reasons to have small islanded localized grids. That's one. Another really interesting thing that's happened is that probably the biggest accelerator to the expansion of mobile in Africa and the developing world was the fact that they created prepaid accounts. So you want to use the phone, you pay someone $10, I don't have to worry about collecting the money or anything else. You use your however many minutes you got for that $10, come back for more. Now there are all kinds of firms out there that are creating smart meters. And this has been around for a while, but the technology is getting better and cheaper so that people can buy energy as and when they need it. That's an advance as well. And I think one of the most interesting things by far that's happening, there was just USAID, for example, just launched a big grand challenge on refrigeration. You know, there are all types of things that you can do. I mean, let's assume that everybody, when they can afford it, they're going to want that TV, refrigerator, dishwasher, and or not maybe not dishwasher, but clothes washer. There's this amazing video that Hans Rosling does, if you know his work on dishwashers and the transformation that they've made for women around the world. Again, clothes washers, not dishwashers. If we can find ways towards radical affordability that makes all of those things much cheaper and use much less energy, that's going to be huge. And you look at, I don't know what the life of a clothes washer is in the United States, but 10, maybe 20 years if you're lucky. And then you'll think about buying the next one. People who don't have them don't have to think about waiting until they can buy the next one. So there are huge opportunities like that out there.
30-second answer, add on to that question. I traveled across in a car in the state of Nevada. Where's the guy who asked the question? I lost him. I traveled across the state of Nevada in a car with a really, really extraordinarily highly trained geologist once about 25 years ago, and I kept asking him questions about the things we were seeing because I didn't know much about geology, and he kept answering the same way, depends on. Every time I'd ask him a question, he'd say, depends on. I think the answer to your question is depends on, because in Botswana they have a lot of coal and they want to use it. In Ethiopia they have a tremendous amount of hydro resources. In the Rift Valley they have tremendous geothermal. But the thing to bear in mind is that when you think about Africa, and particularly sub-Saharan Africa, is that this is a political issue as much as it is an energy resource issue. In the country of Rwanda, they're trying to get off a system that now has about 150 megawatts. It's nothing for a country of 10 or 12 million people, and elevate. But they're finding out that they don't have the physical resources. There's a limited amount of methane gas available. There is no natural gas. There is no oil. There's some solar potential that's good, but there is no wind. it's dependent on, in Rwanda's case, having solid political agreements with the surrounding countries so that they can exchange power from the Rift Valley geothermal projects and from the Kenyan and Tanzanian hydro projects. So there is no silver bullet, as John was saying earlier.
If I can just add something with in Africa, I mean, not just Africa, also Southeast Asia. I mean, the Chinese, while it's, glowing green pandas maybe for their energy, but China's overseas investments, it's a growing concern now that a lot of their investment is actually going into coal-fired power plants. They've just built the largest coal-fired power plant in Pakistan. And they're, they're reaching further out. And some of it, too, is I've heard that it's kind of like, it's also an employment thing because you have these people that know how to run coal-fired power plants. And so it's becoming another one of their exports. But I did agree with you, it kind of depends on. I'm also thinking of the water issue because energy, all energy needs water. And so, but one thing that we haven't talked about now, if there's an interest, the issue of wastewater or sludge to energy, methane capture and utilization. I'm starting a new project. I've been working with the EPA's Global Methane Initiative. We were scoping out the potential in these huge Chinese cities that are making lots of waste and lots of wastewater. And, waste is not sexy, but as I've been looking into it, it's like, wow, there's a lot of potential power. I was just in Hawaii. I just came back last night, and I gave a talk, but I also went to their waste to sludge power plant because I'm weird. Because most people go to the beach, but I go to sludge power plant. Because I'm actually starting an investigation in the United States because what Chinese want to know, what's working here. And so that's something, too. And I think that and even in Africa, they want to know, what works here that could work there. So I will shut up.
Great. We had a question right there.
This will take a minute, sorry. My question is, if I were a developing nation, why would I build a coal-fired plant? And maybe why would I build a gas turbine power plant? And here's the background. Solar and coal is up here. Solar price is down somewhat consistent with natural gas, and both at the bottom of current technology. Wind is in there too. Developing nation, you need a 200-ton crane to build a coal-fired plant. You don't install solar panels. You do need storage for solar, but pumped hydro has been around, storage has been around since 1890s in Europe, 1930s in the US for coal plants for nighttime storage and load sharing. So I'm missing the, I don't get it. CO2 is a big deal for climate change.
One example, I actually was in India giving some talks, and I found out the Rockefeller Foundation gave support to an Indian company to try to bring electrification in very poor areas of Bihar. And they came up with the idea that there are these cell phone towers. How are they powered? Diesel, right? That's really horrible. Well, then what they did is they put in these solar panels, and so the village, they didn't need all the electricity. And then they sold the clean electricity to the cell tower folks, and you suddenly had, woohoo, we have a market. And I think that's sometimes what's missing, is that when, because, there's hundreds and hundreds of examples, I'm sure in your work in developing countries, throwing clean energy at a place, and they're like, it doesn't get connected to anything. But innovative models like this, bringing the kind of the business angle into it to a very far out rural place, I don't know, that's my example. What do you got?
Well, I was just going to pick up on something critical that you said that I think is so important for this whole discussion, because we often get caught up in energy and electrification. Actually, it doesn't matter. It's not about energy and electrification. It's actually about development. It's about what you do with that energy. And so it's so critical, and this is a problem, and that you have to think about what are the productive uses of energy that are going to enable green, sustainable, inclusive growth in the places that we are talking about. That's the end goal. And it doesn't matter where the energy is produced or how it's produced, the end goal. Now, it does matter from a climate consequence, but we always have to be thinking about that, which means we therefore have to be thinking about just not like, let's go out willy-nilly and create lots of energy. You have to really think about these communities, their economies, how they're going to use that, and what are the types of inputs and programs that are going to be necessary to help them grow and develop and use that energy in productive ways. And if you're not thinking about that side of it, then electrification electrification for electrification's sake can be as problematic as it can be helpful.
We've got 40 seconds. We're going to do a lightning round. Each of you gets 15 seconds to either tell us what you're most hopeful about or what's the biggest challenge you see.
I don't know how that happened. Well, my time's up. I am most hopeful these days because I, and this is a hope that's born out of my own experience. I teach a lot of young students. I teach renewable energy law and policy regularly at the two law schools here in Colorado and courses on sustainable energy and sustainable development. And I have the great pleasure to meet so many young, inspired, motivated people in graduate programs and postgraduate programs. And that's why I'm hopeful, is that there are people who are taking an interest, a serious interest, who are learning and who are doing things they should be doing, like reading Bill Ritter's book. And if there are any students out there who haven't read the book, get on with it.
Great. Alex.
I am most hopeful that when you look at how development has progressed around the world in the last couple of decades, that more and more of the countries that we are talking about and thinking about when we talk about developing countries are increasingly on a path to self-reliance. And the reason that makes me most hopeful is because, as somebody who's worked in development their whole career, it's not about us. We are not the ones who drive this. We are not the ones who can successfully bring it. The only iron law of development is local ownership. And that rise in local ownership and people genuinely caring about and measuring things like how we're using energy and how we're producing clean energy is ultimately, in my opinion, the thing that's going to make all this work.
Jennifer, you get the last word.
I direct the China Environment Forum, so I have to be happy the fact that the China, they're turning the cold Titanic, right? And but that turn has happened in great part because of this diverse community, you know, in the US, NGO, business, government, and researchers who've been working with the Chinese and building up kind of networks that are independent of like the presidential stuff that goes on. Usually when there's an election, all this cooperation has to start all over again. So yeah, I'm optimistic that the Titanic is turning, and now it's you.
Spoiler alert, the Titanic sunk.
Oh, it did. No. No, it's turning, and it didn't hit the iceberg.
Help me thank our great panel.
Melted.